We are here to talk about an agree order and a public participation plan, and these were inviting public comment for both of these documents. And I just want to make sure everyone knows that we have forms that you can fill out tonight. If you have something on the tip of your tongue, you'd really like to submit a comment with us tonight, you're welcome to. They're kind of scattered across the back of the room. You're also welcome to submit written comments via email. You can mail it to us. We'll have information about how to do that later. And all of these comments are going to become part of the formal record of the site, and we'll also provide a responsiveness summary to address the comments that we receive. What else? The documents that are available for review and comment are available online. Here now for reference, there are also copies at the Shelton Library and at the Lacey Department of Ecology office in the Southwest region. If you have any questions about how to access those, you're welcome to talk to me. And I also just want to point out that there's a feedback form that I'll have next to the door that just asks some questions about how the meeting was tonight. So if you have any opinions, pros or cons, or thoughts that you'd like us to take the next time you come here to give a talk or have a meeting, you're welcome to leave those for me. We really pay attention. And with that, I think I'll just open up our presentation tonight. Rebecca Lawson is going to start. She's going to provide us an overview and set the context for the project. Rebecca is the manager. Come on up. Rebecca manages the Department of Ecology's cleanup work for the Southwest region. And she and Joyce both have spent a lot of time working in the
project. Thanks, Megan. Thanks, everybody, for coming out tonight. Really appreciate you taking the time. And like Megan said, the focus of tonight is to talk about the work that's going to be performed in Shelton Harbor under this agreed order between the Department of Ecology and Simpson. But first, I'd like to, and this is, I'm going to have to get used to this part. First, I'd like to just take a minute and set some context. We have a state cleanup law, the Model Toxics Control Act, or MOTFA as we call it. We're full of acronyms in the state government. And we also have a companion sediments regulation called the Sediment Management Standards. And so those are the regulations that guide the investigation and cleanup work that we do. So under the Model Toxics Control Act, our cleanup process begins when we get information that there's contamination at a site, and it goes on a list that we have of confirmed and suspected contaminated sites. And then the next step is often a site hazard assessment, where if we could get some sense of priority about whether we should work on that site first, or maybe there's another one that's a higher priority. Sites don't have to have a site hazard assessment for us to work on them. And a real foundation piece of the cleanup process is the remedial investigation. That is where we take the soil samples, the sediment samples, we analyze them, and we determine the nature and extent of contamination. Now, we can also do interim actions at any point in the process. And an interim action would be something that we could just go ahead and do without waiting to go through this whole process. So maybe there's a lot of circumstances where it would make sense to do an interim action, and Joyce is actually going to talk about one tonight. But say you had some contaminated soil that was leaching into the creek or something, you could go ahead and dig that out now to stop that without having to wait until you go through this whole process. So again, interim actions can be done at any point in the process. After the remedial investigation, we do a feasibility study. So once we know the nature and extent of contamination, we evaluate different cleanup options to take care of the contamination. And those are laid out in the feasibility study. And then Ecology, the Department of Ecology, selects the cleanup remedy. And that is laid out in a cleanup action plan. And the cleanup action plan is typically implemented under a formal agreement, either an agreed order or a consent decree. And then once the cleanup's done, we need to do some monitoring to make sure the cleanup did what we thought it was going to do. So that's just a little background about the cleanup process. That one, just like my mouth sometimes. So why are we looking at Oakland Bay? Back in 2006, then Governor Greg Moore instituted the Puget Sound Initiative to focus on restoring the health of Puget Sound. And the Department of Ecology's response to that was to identify 7 priority abatements that either had historic or ongoing industry. And 3 of those are in the southwest region that I manage, and that would be Port Angeles, Oakland Bay, and Bud Inlet. And we have completed sediments investigation in all 3 of those abatements. So back in 2008 and 2009, we did a pretty comprehensive sediments investigation in Oakland Bay and Shelton Harbor. And that report was finalized in 2010, and we came out and held a public meeting much like this and shared in a lot more detail than I'm going to go into tonight the results of that study. So it was pretty comprehensive. We looked for a wide variety of contaminants based on the industries that are present in and around Oakland Bay. And there are some compounds from wood debris, hydrogen sulfide and ammonia, that can be toxic to marine life. We also evaluated impacts to marine life by doing what we call bioassays. And that's where we take some of the sediment and some of the marine water, we take it into a lab, and we put different kinds of marine critters, different types of worms, and we monitor them to see the effects from being exposed to these sediments, and we look to see if they die or if they have any growth impairment or all sorts of things like that. So we sampled at over 50 stations in Oakland Bay and Shelton Harbor, so it was very comprehensive. And Joyce, when she takes over, she'll talk more specifically about the results for Shelton Harbor, because that sets the stage for this new work we're going to be doing in Shelton Harbor. So what did we find? We found elevated levels of dioxins and PAHs, which are polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And we also found elevated levels of the wood debris compounds that I just mentioned. And we did have some bioassay variation. So initially, the dioxins were our greatest concern. And I know this is kind of hard to see. I think there might be a map of this in the back. But here are the results for surface sediments, dioxins and surface sediments. And for a frame of reference, Puget Sound background would be about 4 parts per trillion. That's a really small amount. And you may or may not be able to see that all of these concentrations are in the range of 20 to 60 parts per trillion. And then we have even higher concentrations in Shelton Harbor. So we were kind of concerned when we saw these results. And we were definitely concerned about the shellfish industry and, I'll get to that in a second, sorry. So why do we care about dioxins? Dioxins are very persistent in the environment. They tend to bind on to soil and sediment, which means they don't leach out into water very readily. And the main pathway of exposure that we're concerned about is through bioaccumulation. And what that means is the fish in contact with the sediments uptake the dioxins, it gets into their tissue, we eat the fish, and then it gets into our tissue. And they tend to persist. So that is why we are concerned about them. And where do they come from? They're byproducts from industrial processes, and they're also a byproduct of burning, whether that's wood or very typical were hog fuel boilers. In the old days, with any mill or pulp mill, they used to burn the wood that was soaked in water. water, so it had chlorine, and when you burn that, it releases dioxins. And it's also a byproduct of forest fires and volcanoes. And so again, in Open Bay, you could find these contaminants in pulp mill and sawmill discharges, and particularly in the ash and other deposits from these old hog fuel boilers, which were very prevalent. And I want to point out that these new biomass burners that maybe you've heard about, they don't have the same issue with air emissions because they burn at such much higher temperature. It's a more complete combustion. So they don't tend to have the same issues. Okay. So when we saw these results, we were concerned about shellfish. There's a huge shellfish industry in Open Bay. And we were concerned about people who came in contact with the sediments. We partnered with the State Department of Health. They did a health consult, and that included analyzing some of the shellfish tissue. And I'm going to read their results because the wording matters. So the State Department of Health concluded that touching, breathing in, or accidentally eating sediment containing dioxin and total CPAH from Oakland Bay is not likely to harm people's health. And eating shellfish from Oakland Bay is not likely to produce harmful effects even for people who eat a lot of these products. So what this told us was this is not an immediate threat. We didn't need to get in there immediately and get this cleanup done. However, it also doesn't mean that, we're just not worried about it. And we do want to work toward getting the sediments cleaned up. And we're starting in Shelton Harbor because, again, that's where the highest concentrations were. And in terms of the rest of Oakland Bay, it's got its challenges. It's a huge area. It will be a while before we have a plan to tackle that, but we felt let's start with Shelton Harbor. That's where the highest concentrations are. So that just kind of sets a little bit of the context for why we entered into this agreed order with Simpson, and then Joyce is going to talk more about what specifically we're going to do under this agreed order, and that's the work that we appreciate your comments on if you have them. So with that, I will introduce Joyce Mercury, and you can do that quickly.
Okay, so thanks for coming tonight. Like Rebecca said, I see a lot of familiar faces and I met some new people tonight. Appreciate you coming. So I'm a cleanup project manager in the Southwest region of Ecology, and I work on cleanup sites and sediments as well as the uplands. And I've been assigned to this project since we did the sediment investigation report in 2008. So I'm just going to give you a really short overview of some of the data that kind of zoom in on Shelton Harbor, and then talk about what's in the agreed order. Also, Scott Stelzman from the Fox Island Tribe is going to give a little bit of an overview of a habitat improvement restoration project. It's very integral to this project that we're in now. And then we'll have some time again for questions. So these are the sampling locations, just kind of zoom in at the thing that Rebecca showed you before. It was what she said, we tested chemicals as well as looking for wood and wood byproducts. And the dioxin results in Shelton Harbor were highest that we found throughout the system. In this map, the pink and the orange are the highest concentrations. Up there, the mouth of the creek and down here in the corner of the bay is where we found the highest levels. This area here is where the pulp mill that was here many, many years ago was discharged. The highest concentrations we found were around 200 parts per trillion. Now, 200 sounds like a big number. Part per trillion is a very small amount. But it is still above what you would find, like Rebecca said, the reference that we would compare that to, just for frame of reference, is the background in an uncontaminated or a natural area of Puget Sound, which would be more like 4 parts per trillion.
Okay, that's the wrong button.
So the other thing that we were concerned about is looking for wood deposits. It's very common in our legacy in our state. It's been very much of our economy. We found it in timber industries. So sometimes there's a if we end up with deposits of wood in the water. And the reason why that's a concern is because it can generate toxic chemicals like sulfides, ammonia, and it can also just provide a low oxygen environment, and it's not a good substrate for marine critters to live on. So this map here, what they did was they did sediment cores, where they basically drill into the sediments and evaluate what's present there. And each one of these little squares would represent like 1 foot of depth. And then each core, as you can see, was a different depth, depending on how far they were able to get the machine to go down before it got infused, and or when they got to the point where they weren't finding wood. So the darker is the higher percent of wood. And typically the wood is going to be bark, wood chips, and sometimes sawdust. So, as I said before, we're concerned about the wood because it can create a toxic environment and an inhospitable environment for marine life. And so we run these bioacid tests that Rebecca talked about, where we take sediments, take them to the lab, and subject critters to them. And we're trying to determine if they're growing normally, if they're reproducing normally, and basically if they're even surviving in some cases. So in this case, so for each station we tested, we ran 4 different tests. And the yellow and the red represent areas that had indications of toxicity according to our state regulation for sediments. So that was another reason why that's kind of a bigger concern for us in Shelton Harbor. So because the Shelton Harbor area, as Rebecca said, has these higher levels, it's a place we really wanted to get started. But at the same time that we're interested in doing this cleanup, there's this area here that's in the orange that is slated for a habitat improvement restoration. So for the past several years, several parties in this area have collaborated. Squaxin Tribe, South Puget Sound Salmon Enhancement Group, Port of Shelton, City of Shelton, Mason Conservation District, as well as Simpson Timber, who owns much of this property, are making development, have been collaborating to try to develop a plan for how to restore habitat in this area. So, as I said, a significant part of this habitat restoration is here. There's also some other accessory things that are going on that have to do with land preservation and even point and what have you. So this is a chance for us to kind of partner with the habitat. And it's really exciting to us, the idea that we can work together to try to create a more hospitable and healthy environment for salmon and for people. And one of the main points that I'm going to make, too, is that we feel like it would make no sense to divorce these from each other. They need to be collaborated, and we want to have this be efficient and have the cleanup be the foundation for this area that's going to be for smolts and salmon enhancement. So, all that is kind of background and context for the kind of the meat of the matter, which is why we're here, is to talk about this agreed order that Simpson Timber has agreed to enter into with Ecology and provide them. Okay, so what is actually in this agreed order? An agreed order is basically a legal contract between Ecology and the party that's entering into it. And it's agreed because both parties are agreeing to do it. So this particular order is going to involve developing a work plan that's going to be for sampling and other studies that are needed to augment the data we already have and what we already know about Shelton Harbor, to try to identify which areas need to be cleaned up, how bad they are, which areas don't need to be cleaned up, to really kind of wrap it all up so we can move forward with the cleanup plan. That will be wrapped up into a remedial investigation report. There will also be a feasibility study report, and that is where they look at all these different options that you could use to clean up and weigh them against each other. We have criteria and regulation that need to be permanent, that need to be protective. That all culminates eventually in a draft cleanup action plan for all Shelton Harbor. That doesn't mean all Shelton Harbor gets cleaned up. The parts that are identified need to be cleaned up. Draft cleanup action plan identifies what has to happen in each area. That draft cleanup action plan in and of itself will be subject to a public comment period. That's down the road from here, though. So meanwhile, as Rebecca mentioned, the whole idea of interim action, we wanted to have provision in the order for interim action just to make sure that we would be able to be ready with an action for the first phase of the habitat And like she said, the interim action is where you can develop a cleanup plan for a portion of your bigger area to be done sooner or to be done in a different manner. It just provides flexibility and the nimbleness that we need to be able to respond to situations like that. So the investigation that they're going to do is going to involve evaluating to see if there's ongoing sources. Most of the people, we very strongly believe that the contamination in the bay is from legacy historical sources. But every time you do a sediment cleanup and look for, we just evaluate, could there be current ongoing sources? Because we don't want it to get recontaminated once it gets cleaned up. One of the potential sources is there's a deposit, we're calling it a clinker deposit. It's a landfill area of what appears to be residues from boilers. Clinker is this very hard consolidated material that comes out of the bottom of boilers after the wood and what have you is burned. And that has been deposited between the railroad, right around the course, it goes around the corner of Highway 3, and Shelton Creek. So we want to make sure that that's not leaching anything that could then be contaminated sediments. They'll also be looking at a little bit more at the extent of the wood debris and the deposits. And they'll be doing more bioassays, partly to get more fresh and new information, because that's been 10 years since we had the other ones, and partly because some of the test protocols have changed and we believe that they're much more accurate now than they used to be. We'll also be looking for sulfides, because that is an indicator of one of the toxic chemicals that we found in the 2010 report, and it's also an indicator of what can be toxic in wood. Lastly, they're looking at this potential for recovery, which is where they go out and try to determine how fast is new sediment accumulating in the bay. It can be accumulating from fresh, clean sediments coming out from Goldsboro Creek or Shelton Creek. And that's important to know when you're trying to develop a cleanup plan, because you might want to know if we left it, just left it all by itself, how long it would take to recover the sediment. That folds into your decisions. That's one of the elements that you look at when you're making. So again, the interactions, the main goal of having an interaction provision in this order is to be ready for the first phase of habitat construction next year. We want to make sure cleanup issues are resolved before restoration begins, and or that we have a plan in place so that it can be efficiently orchestrated together. And the plan for that is to be on the ground constructing that first phase of the habitat. Salt marsh construction in fall 2018. So I'd like to invite Scott Stelter to come up and give a little chat about the habitat plan so we can kind of see how this all goes together.
Thanks.
The middle thing there is the red
Some biologists with the Salton Tribe, and I wanted to pivot really quick, and we're just going to talk about an upcoming habitat project that's going on. Now, this is not part of the cleanup, and normally we wouldn't be discussing with this, but as was talked about earlier, these two projects meld together, and they're really dependent on each other. And in my mind, at least, the sediment cleanup wouldn't be happening now at this time unless we were doing the restoration, and we can't do the restoration without the whole sediment thing as far as that. So, as Joyce went through earlier, there are a lot of partners within this, and I want to call out special ones are the landowners and the land managers with this. Simpson, which owns the pipeline, where almost all the work is going on. SPI owns shorelines within this that are vital to some of this that's going on, and the Port of Shelton are the owners, and it's really important with that. So, in general, what we're looking at is, you heard it, it's an industrial harbor. It's been this way for over 100 years. Some of the problems with industrialization in harbors we've been talking about, and that's what Ecology is dealing with. But another one is that this thing has been dredged out completely. Most of what you're seeing in the shoreline is fill. It was taken off and dredged from the mouth of Goldsboro and Shelton Creeks, which had estuaries and made new shorelines within this entire thing. So we came up with a project to do the restoration on that to try and restore the estuary within that. So what's going to happen really quickly is on the number one site, we're going to be putting about 14 log structures in that, and this is working on Simpson Landing, Southeast South Sand Enhancement Structure. The idea with these logs, and I'll touch on this a little more, is that they're going to take energy from the stream and just dissipate it and start dropping sediment. Number two is going to be the salt marsh recreation, salt marsh that's been lost within that, and I've got a poster back there that kind of shows the salt marsh areas are going to go. Also on the poster, I completely forgot to put Simpson's logo on there. They're like probably the most important partner we got on that, so I apologize on that. But it gives you a basic idea of where everything is going within that whole thing. Number three is the port shoreline. That's the whole north shoreline of the Ecology port shoreline. That's working with the Port of Shelton and the Mason Conservation District. And that's a planning exercise of what to do that entire bulkhead thing. And then number four, which is actually completed right now, and this is outside of the work area in this area, that's Eagle Point. And that was a purchase of land. And that just finished in December, so that's now Mason County's newest park. And so that part's done. So why are we doing this fairly expensive project in a really highly industrialized area? And it really has to do with Goldsboro Creek. So Goldsboro runs right through the city of Shelton, runs through the old Simpson and out at Sierra Pacific Mills, and was the mouth of the estuary of this whole thing. What you're looking at here are numbers of smolts of juvenile fish that come out from Goldsboro Creek. And what happened in 2001, down in this area, there was a dam removed, basically in the city of Shelton, that was complete fish blockage. So 2001 would have been the year, the last, the first year with no hatchery influence. You know, back in the day, DFW used to put hatchery fish everywhere, and you're seeing the remnants of that there. There's probably about 300 smolts that made it out. Everything's been natural production since then, and it's just gone up and up and up, and to the point of 2 years ago, we were 120,000 in there, and we're at 70,000 this year, and we're still fishing, we're still counting at this point. The system, what tells me, is in really good shape upstream, it's completely taken off all on its own. So now this is the second biggest producer of coho in South Sound, outside of the Nisqually, and that 100,000 smolt area is the Nisqually type numbers, river type numbers within that. So we want to be able to do, what can we do that's obviously working upstream, what can we do to help it? And that's why we're proposing this project to go forward. Nothing really new that we're doing here is not that new. And what I want to point out, kind of the top, it's just graphic in here. The really dark color is like native material. So if they're going to do this cleanup, and part of it might be putting material down to cap on that, all we have to do then is put some more material, raise it up to the elevation, and then start getting salt marsh within that. And this has been done before. This isn't entirely new. We're kind of basing some of this work on what was done in Commencement Bay off the mouth of the Jollof system. And I think it's important to note that the landowner there was Simpson, and the engineering firm doing the work is Anchor. Same people who are doing the same thing that we're doing down here. So we have some experience doing these kind of things. So in a couple places down there, they take what would have been mud flats in an area that should have been vegetated, grow it up, and now they have vegetated areas that's still being monitored today. So it's not entirely anything new. It's been done before. So what you are going to see in the next year or so, and we're actually, I want to point out, all our partners get together, we're going to have some community presentations on this where I can really get into this in depth. This is just how I want to tie this into the bigger thing. But starting in this fall, 2017, the South Hugestown Sand Enhancement Group will be putting about 14 log structures into this area. So that's going to be the first thing that you see that start going on with construction. And then we're looking about 2018 to start doing one of the salt marshes. It's a big project. It's really large, even at a huge sound scale. So what's been done so far with that is about a third of a mile has been protected on Eagle Point. 14 acres of riparian, that whole thing within Eagle Point is, you can actually add 4 acres of piling as part of that too. We'll be removing all the creosote pilings that are in the whole bay. And if you can think of that whole area, there's 811 of them, there's a lot of it. All that's going to be coming out within that. Working with Sierra Pacific Industries to plan and potentially remove up to a quarter mile of the dike going across that, and half a mile of riparian zone, and half a mile of bulkheads being planned to remove across the thing. That's huge. That's even at a huge soundwide scale, that's a lot going in there. And 47 acres of new salt marsh being created across the whole thing. So that's just a quick touch on how we're trying to tie these two together. I'm going to be here the rest of the night to ask questions. Brian Combs from the South Hugestown Sand Enhancement Group in the back in the blue shirt leading up to construction will be here to answer questions. Thank you.
Great, thanks a lot, Scott. So what's going to happen next? Where we are now is in finalizing the inquiry order. This is the public comment period until the end of June.
These are public comment periods, a little conversation bubble. So then this summer, we'll be doing the investigation, the field work for the investigation. And once they have enough information to understand what might need to be done in the area where the first, the logjam thing that Scott talked about is really a first phase, but I'm talking about the first phase of the actual salt marsh construction. So once they get the field work done this summer, start to develop the intermaction work plan. Now, when the intermaction work plan is complete, or when it's finally drafted, that also goes out for public comment. Because even though the order has provisions to develop it, you know, we want the public to know what it is and be able to comment on it before we actually implement it. And then next year will be the actual construction of the intermaction, which will be orchestrated with the habitat design. And then the remedial investigation feasibility study will come out in a report that is usually going to be a combined report. And then there will be a draft cleanup action plan that covers the whole sediment cleanup unit of Shelton Harbor. Those two things will be rolled up in a public comment period as well. Probably what will happen at the point which we're going to draft cleanup action plan, then we'll renegotiate a new order to actually implement the cleanup. So that would include cleanup in other parts of Shelton Harbor that weren't already covered under the intervention. So we're inviting the comments, Megan said, on the agreed order, as well as the public participation plan, which she mentioned. That plan is just outlines how we're going to communicate with you, i.e. having this meeting tonight, fact sheets, that kind of thing. We just want to make sure that we're reaching people how they need to be reached. And we do accept written comments, can be handwritten. There's some forms here today if you want to start making your comments. You can send more in if you think of this other stuff later. And the comment, or by email to me. And I'll show you that in a minute. And then the end of the comment period is the 26th of this month. So you'll send your comments to this address, to me, at my email. At my email or my snail mail address. This information is in the fact sheet that you've either gotten the mail or it's available in the back of the room. The actual documents are available on this website, and again, that's available in the fact sheet. And, the hard copies are at the Shelton Library, and there's a few copies here so you can just come look at it. We can bring a whole lot. And also, feel free to call me if you want to ask any questions before you comment, if you have anything that you want to get clarification on. So now, we're going to just have some questions, question and answer time. And I don't know how long Megan's going to hold that for, but even after the formal question and answer, we'll still be here in the room for a little bit if you just want to ask me more online on the basis. So I'm going to let you do that, Megan, and I will turn the lights up a little bit.
Okay. I just want to reiterate that this is the slide deck that we presented tonight, and lots of copies of this are still available, and those website addresses and places our mailing address and everything is listed in print on here, and on the fact sheet, which there's also lots of copies available in that. So we have Q&A time now. This is the part we've probably been waiting for, and I'm just standing here to offer to facilitate. If there's lots of questions, I can kind of try to organize to the best of our ability. So, open up. Anybody have any questions? Or please talk about. Ms. Patricia.
A couple of questions. How is this agreed order going to be any different than what happened in the one between Rainier and Bruce Lake, which was done April 1st, 2001, and it still hasn't happened until today when it was decided then? So yes, it's true. We've been working for a long time on that agreed order with Rainier for Goose Lake, but we have been making progress, and we are just about to finally get what we hope is the final draft of the remedial investigation report. I think what's going to make this agreed order different is we've got a timeline to try to implement this restoration plan, which everybody's really excited about. It's a really cool thing. And I think we'll get through the investigation of the rest of the harbor. I feel pretty optimistic. I don't think this is going to drag on for a decade. Pardon me?
For 16 years?
Yes. Yes, they have been.
I just like to quickly touch on that too. We do have very cooperative and collaborative and motivated parties, Simpson Timbers, really interested. I mean, they've had a presence in Shelton for many years, and they really like to have this thing work out and turn out good. And my experience so far with dealing with Simpson is kind of that they're motivated to make it happen.
Well, I also noticed that if you add up the times on the new order, that they have to respond. For instance, what this thing, and it comes out, it was going to be 14 months before it's all finished. If they use the full time.
Yeah.
Honestly, that sounds about right. And that would be really fast, quite honestly, if everything happens exactly the way it's laid out.
Yes, that's what we're here.
But we do have some provisions for being ready. We're going to get this data this summer. And even though the report will be completely written by them, there will be enough information generated to develop an interim action plan such that it can be folded together so that the construction for that can happen in 2018. Now, it is true that the rest of the Shelton Harbor cleanup could take longer than that, and it likely will, because it takes a long time to develop the plans, to synthesize the information, and, you know, to be quite frank, we negotiate, and we have our rules, and we need to make sure they're met, and the parties present information and options to us, and sometimes that takes a while to work out an agreement for them. So I do think that the part that's in the Shelton Harbor Habitat Improvement Restoration Salt Marsh, the early phases that are going to be happening soon, we're going to be ready for that. The rest of the harbor, especially in the south part, it could be a little bit longer. It could be a year or 2 years. Well, probably a year and a half, 2.5 years. Just the lab data, just running samples of the lab alone sometimes can take, you know, 6 weeks, and then they have to be reviewed and synthesized and qualified. So it's a long process. But I know just from my experience, we're all very motivated to make it happen.
It is a
long
process.
Is there a price tag attached to this? And what are the funding sources?
The price tag attached to the cleanup part of it?
Yes.
The cleanup is paid for by the liable party, which in this case is Simpson Timber. And at this time, I'm not privy to their price tag for this investigation. That's not really something that we get directly involved in. And they will also be responsible for the cost of the cleanup. And they will have the option, if they wish to recover from other parties that might have contributed to the contamination. The cleanup elements are privately funded. They are not state or federally funded. Dave?
Yes, along those lines, can Ecology enter into another order with the responsible party based on their information?
Another order with a different responsible party?
Is the way to have further participation only by Simpson recovering funds, or can Ecology unilaterally also approach other parties and have a response action?
Okay, thanks for your question, Dave. So if you didn't hear, earlier I had said that Simpson would be responsible because they have stepped up to agree with this order, and that's part of the agreement is that they're responsible for the cost. They could recover from other parties that have liability. But it is also possible that Ecology could approach other parties and fold them into the process and into an order, to which point we were both parties, or however many there were. The reason we haven't done that right now is because Simpson Timber is stepping up and wants to do it, and that is often a lot more efficient and effective. But we certainly could pull in other parties at some other times.
Yeah, I'd also like to clarify that there are multiple liable parties. We don't need all of them to work with us. We just need one of them to step up and work with us. And then under our state cleanup law, there are ways that PLP that stepped up and did the work can cost recovery from the other PLPs. So Ecology doesn't necessarily have to be in the middle of that. Because if we had to get everybody to the table before we could do anything, it would take
a lot longer, to Patricia's point. I mean, it would be really hard to ever get anything done. So we just need one who says, okay, I'm willing to work with you. And usually, things go quicker that way.
Does the sewage treatment plant play any role in the sediment contamination?
We do believe that the sewage treatment plant could have been one of the ways that some of the contamination for dioxin was spread into the bay. Kind of a long story, but whether it was...
So they discharge chlorine?
It's not from the chlorine that they're discharging, but they, many, many years ago, the ash from the boiler, and as Rebecca said, we take this wood, it's salty from being transported salt water, it goes into a boiler, a burner, low temperature, inefficient, creates ash. That's captured in the air pollution control bags, essentially, as a filter. There was a period of time when that material was basically slurry into the sewage treatment plant as a mechanism of removing it. And that was at both treatment plants, the one on Pine Street and the one at Eagle Point. They kind of overlap, each one had like 4 years worth of doing this. So, but in and of themselves, like local municipal sewage probably wouldn't cause very high dioxin. We wouldn't expect that that much. But in this particular case, because that ash was sent through there, they kind of were the vehicle for potentially having it redistributed. And at the time, nobody really knew that that was what that was going to be. That's a good question. Your thoughts or questions?
Yeah? I'm really concerned about the ash. I'm concrete about it. And the one that's the most toxic is this 2378 TCBV, what they use in the 81 machine, they spray over in Vietnam. And in May of 2008, I believe, Herrera did the investigation as a consultant.
Mm-hmm.
And they had only tested all around water in that, but they went into the plant and got samples of the ash and tested that. And it's my understanding that the maximum level, this stuff is so contaminated, that in drinking water, it's 0.30 parts per quadrillion. That's how toxic it is. And soluble, it's 3 to 11 parts per trillion. When they did the testing, they had readings of 4,200 parts per trillion. And that they created a lot of ash. And that stuff was dumped everywhere. They dumped it up in the C Street landfill, the county landfill, the David Simpson landfill. That really got just saturated with it. And there didn't seem to be any testing of any of that to see how much more of that is around. And it's horribly, horribly toxic. In fact, the Dayton Simpson landfill was closed, and there wasn't even a public hearing about it. And you can't find out any information about it. So that just is, I think, a very, very great concern.
Well, I want to point out one small thing about, you're right, dioxin is a concern, and the 2378 TCD is the most toxic type. When we give the numbers that we give for concentrations, it's like 36 different kinds of dioxins that we typically, it's dioxins and furans, which are very similar. They all get kind of folded together in this equivalency factor, which is...
But they use that one, that's the one that everything is gauged against, and those are the ones where I've seen the readings.
Right. Yeah. So, well, and then every dioxin was expressed in terms of that, yes. But I also want to point out that the work that you're talking about, when they found the 4,200, that was in the early 1980s. Herrera reported in their report about that study, but they did not test the ash at that time. By the time Herrera did their report, the boilers had been improved and modernized to the point where they're burning at this super high temperature that didn't create it. There was, back in the 80s, there absolutely was a lot of ash generated. C Street Landfill is actually being investigated right now. Goose Lake's being investigated. And this is Shelton Harbor now. The landfill, the Dayton landfill, I have to confess, I'm not really that familiar with it. I know that the Ecology Solid Waste Program did a closure on it. And I don't, I'm sure that the information's available through a file review, but I have to confess I can't speak to it right now. Yeah, it might require an actual request for the file.
But there are tons and tons of this really toxic ash that was just taken and dumped everywhere. And it wasn't covered up either. It was just left that way. So it keeps adding this dioxin binds with soil. But if it's hot and dusty, that stuff can get blown anywhere. You can get it on your shoes. You can inhale it.
It is my understanding, and I don't want to minimize your concern because I understand that it's a big concern. But it is my understanding about landfill in particular that it's not like laying on the surface. It is embedded within layers of soil and probably some water debris and stuff. It also came from the mill at the time. And it doesn't really like dissolve into water. It just really doesn't. Well, if there's some dioxin, it does dissolve into water. If it encounters a soil particle, it'll stick to it. It's just the nature of the chemical. So, yes, it's a concern, but from my experience, I don't really think it is freely floating around the environment. I mean, even in Shelton Harbor in open day, where we're finding it in sediments, it's been there a long time, so it's not really likely to be moving around a lot. It's a concern, but I don't think it's in the form that it's going to just like fly in the air as much.
If it's dry and hot, it blows around a lot. And it also adheres to any tissue. So if it's near your crustacean, it'll attach to that tissue. As it would fish, if it's in the water, and the fish come up in the water, you take that in, it would attach to that tissue.
And that is why we're concerned about it, and that's why we want to regulate it and try to clean it up. The Department of Health study did, they actually got a bunch of clams, and there's about 10 or 15 locations around Oakland Bay. I was there, we were planning that day. We, they shelled them, ground up the meat. They didn't test fish because shellfish was the biggest thing that happened. That's the big resource here. There's not a lot, as far as we have, we're around 12 miles of crab fishing and stuff. So they tested primarily the shellfish, and the concentrations that came out in the shellfish tissue were really very low. I mean, it's present, you can detect it. But if you compare that to the dioxin that you might find in hamburgers or something, it's really not that different. So evidently, at least at where the shellfish are growing, it's not uptaking into the shellfish very much. But it is a concern. I understand that's why we're doing the work that we do, is to try to address it and seal it off or remove it.